Advised of flashing images now as we join hosts past and present and a special gathering of guests to celebrate 50 years of The Late Late Show.
The Late Late Show has covered a lot in 50 years, just like Liberty has in its 100 years.
I got a feeling that tonight's gonna be a good night. That tonight's gonna be a good night. That tonight's gonna be a good, good night. I got a feeling, ooh, that tonight's gonna be a good night. That tonight's gonna be a good night. That tonight's gonna be a good, good night. Tonight's the night, let's live it up. I got my money, let's spin it up. Go out and smash it, like oh my god. Jump out that sofa, let's kick it off.
Gentlemen, to whom it concerns, it's The Late Late Show, and here is your host, Ryan Tubridy.
Special celebration of 50 years of The Late Late Show. On the program tonight, we will be looking back over the last half century of the longest running chat show in the world with the help of a specially invited studio audience, which includes many of the artists and guests who have contributed to the show over the years and who have helped make it what it is today. We're going to kick off tonight with some classic music. Joining our Late Late Show house band for the evening is the RTE Concert Orchestra, led by Mia Cooper and conducted by our very own Golden Globe nominee, Mr. Brian Byrne. To start us off, would you welcome, please, ladies and gentlemen, Horse Lips?
Thank you. are so much better than one.
Ladies and gentlemen, and I'd like to thank Shay Healy for leading the chant from the audience tonight for Horselips. Good man, Shay, or is it you, Bill Cullen? Anyway, it's one of those messers up the front. Horselips, we're joined tonight by special guests: Sharon Corr, Keela's Owen Dillon, Sharon Shannon was there, Mairéne Whaney from Alton was there, and the great banjo player Jerry O'Connor. How about that for a starter, ladies and gentlemen? Come on, love that. Okay. Still a bit of business as usual. Time now for competition. This is a pretty special competition this week. We've teamed up with the National Lottery to mark their limited edition Summer Millionaire Raffle Draw. From just 150,000 tickets, one instant millionaire will be made, with hundreds more cash prizes up for grabs. Tickets are on sale now, and that draw will take place on Monday, August 6th. Now, more information will be found on lottery.ie. To celebrate that, and of course, the Late Late Show's 50th anniversary, we have €50,000 up for grabs tonight. And we're going to make five of you at home €10,000 richer before the night is out. So if your chance to win the lot, answer this question. Which of the following creatures is the emblem of RTE's The Late Late Show? Is it the owl, the squirrel, or the chicken? We said we'd go hard on you tonight. If you know the answer, call 1515-717181 or text late followed by your answer name to 57111. The fact that Brian Kennedy just imitated an owl helps. Viewers in the north can also text to 57111 or call the number on screen. Anna was in tune. Well done. If you enter by text, you won't receive a reply message, so please don't expect one. More details on RTE Airtel page 199. You've got to be over 18 to enter. Lines will close at 11:30 tonight, and we'll call someone. In fact, all five lucky winners will be called live. You've got to be there to take the call, otherwise you don't get the cash. Isn't it time we met our first guest, everybody? Yeah. Well, 50 years ago, my first guest became the first presenter of a new show at the time. It was on RTÉ television, and it was called The Late Late Show. Have a look at this.
OK, if you'll pardon the expression, Roisin, would you roll it there, please?
Live from Tenerife-Sharon, it's The Late Late Show.
I mean, you appear in public like that?
Yes, well, I mean, if you call this public.
Hello, my name is Michael Caine. Not many people know that.
That there was no sex in the Republic until the Late Late Show.
Absolutely right.
It does make it more exciting.
Yes. you know, if somebody's T-shirt.
We're all looking at you, Sinead, out there in television land. They say, Mother of God, what did she do with our head? Isn't that a disgrace? I hope my daughter wouldn't turn out like that. Isn't that what you're saying?
I ain't saying no more about this, except to say just one thing, and this is all I'll say. I never asked or took money from anybody to do favours for anybody in my life.
Well, I'm not so bad myself, okay, as you'd like
agreed
to think.
Agreed. All right.
All right.
Thank you for coming on.
Thank you. Thank you.
Bye. Coming on.
Ladies and gentlemen, would you welcome, please, Mr. Gaybird?
Thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen. That's a lovely warm
standing
welcome.
Standing ovation.
Standing ovation.
How appropriate is that? How are you?
And very well, thank you. I'm still breathing.
Good. Still
more
with
or less.
Us. Can we go back to the start, just as for the night that's in it, Gay, and talk about why it all began, where it all began?
Well, it's an oft-told story,
yeah,
but it all began
version
with a man called Tom McGrath,
yeah,
who was an Irishman working in CBC in Toronto in Canada. And like many others, he came home to join the new fledgling television station, like my own brother Ernest, who became the first executive producer. And Tom had seen The Tonight Show in America. Funnily enough, Johnny Carson started The Tonight Show, started on The Tonight Show the same year The Late Late Show started, 1962. But Tom had been looking at his predecessor and wanted to recreate something like that in Ireland. So it was his idea, and it was a very simple way of making use of an otherwise dark studio during the summer. And it was cheap, and it was ready, and they just bunged it in for a quick filler for 6 weeks or so. And we started in July, and I would have to tell you that everybody detested it.
Really?
Absolutely. Because I think they were expecting, they had been told that there was this new show coming along called The Late Late Show, and they thought it was going to be a variety show, an old-style variety Sunday night show sort of thing. And when they found out it was a talk show, they went stark raving mad.
Yeah.
And that continued for about 4 weeks, and then suddenly, for some reason, I can't account for it, it suddenly became popular. And so it was kept on into the autumn, and so it went on from there.
Brendan Balfe was in the audience.
For the very first.
Where's Brendan?
There's Brendan there. Yeah.
Brendan, how did you end up in the first Late Late Show audience?
Well, we were, two pals of mine, Dennis Connolly and Phil Hanning, we were all fans of Gay, because Gay was the first DJ that spoke remotely like he was in the 20th century.
Yeah.
And we saw a sign, I saw a sign, on a graphic on television, 6 o'clock of a Friday night, audience required, TV show with Gay Byrne, come along. And we came along.
And it was free.
It was free, which was put in the evening. And had a great time. I remember who was on it. I remember it was the panel of three, Verona Mullen, who was the model girl, Danny Cummins, the comedian, and Professor Liam O'Brien, the wiseacre, you might say. And people like Ken Gray were on it, and people like the Noel Keelhan Trio, we're in the corner over there.
Yes.
Played the first seat tune, which
and I think
wrote.
Harry Thulier, Brian.
Harry Thulier was on, but I think he was the announcer, Gay. I think he was the guy who said,
was
ladies
he?
And gentlemen, it's the Late Late Show, here's
was
Gay
he
Byrne.
Really?
Yes, as far as I recall. I may be wrong, but it's most unlikely.
But it's extraordinary.
I doubt it very much.
Most unlikely, yes, yes.
Furthermore, Rosalind Linehan said to somebody only last week, Brendan, that she was on a pilot for The Late Late Show.
Never heard tell of it.
And I've no recollection whatsoever of any pilot being done, but she was asked to do the part of Verona Mullen. And that's where she
was. Oh,
where so she said, yes.
37 years, extraordinary breath of time to do a chat show. And the reaction from the audience here to the clip of Padraig Flynn that night, there was a sort of slightly aghast and jocose reaction to it in many respects. But it was a serious enough thing that he said, an appearance that he made. Did you get the impression when he came into Orty that night that you were in for quite the encounter?
Well, I wasn't, to answer your question. I had no ill will towards the man at all. I'd met him a couple of times, but I didn't know him. But I knew of the family, and I knew they were not exactly shy, retiring porcelain china people. But anyway, he came in that night, and he's a huge man.
Yes.
Now, you're tall, but he would dwarf even you, believe it or not, and he's built in proportion. But I got the distinct impression that night that he was walking down the corridor,
yes,
and he almost had his hands up like that, saying, I have come among you. Is this not the most wonderful night of your career? Now, I'm very biased about Europe, as you know. I hate the whole thing.
Yes.
But anyway, I believe that there is a madness gets into them in Brussels.
Well, before we get into the madness of Brussels, because we've only got 4 hours...
And I think he was suffering from that. I have come among you from Brussels, here I am.
Let's remind ourselves.
Let's
remind ourselves. Slightly lengthier clip,
yes.
Hang on.
That 100,000, I run a home in Dublin, Castlebar, and Brussels. I want to tell you something. Try it sometime when you have a couple of cars and three houses and three homes and a few housekeepers, and I want to tell you and everything else, but remember, it's a well-paid job.
Yeah.
What he didn't realise was that poor Mr. Gilmartin,
yes,
was actually watching the show live, because at that time we had this extraordinary arrangement with some company to do the show live in the UK.
Yes.
It didn't last very long and it's very complicated. But anyway, he was watching in Luton, where he lived. And P. Flynn didn't know that. And so when Mr. Gilmartin heard him saying, well, he's not too well, you know,
yeah,
he's not that deep.
Yeah.
And it was almost like, you know, and his wife is not too well either. In other words, they're both mad.
Yes.
And Mr. Gilmartin got angry.
Yes.
And decided to do something about it there and then, and he was on the phone and all of that.
When Terry Keane came on the show to talk about her relationship with Charles Haughey, well, before I ask you the question, let's just, again, have a quick reminder,
okay,
of what she said to you.
I have to be honest and say I don't regret it. Charlie was a very important part of my life. He shaped me, he changed me in many ways, and we've had a wonderful time together.
Had you known that,
yes,
Terry and Charlie had been an item?
Most people did.
Yeah.
But oddly enough about it, well, she wrote the book, of course,
yes,
and then the Sunday Times bought the serialization,
yes,
rights, and they wanted to get their money back, so they want publicity for that, and they approached us about Terry Keane. And that was it. What is amazing is, no, it didn't shock or amaze me, because I thought most people knew about,
yeah,
it. I certainly knew about it from way back.
Yeah.
But extraordinarily enough, arising out of the interview, we got these lovely letters from people around the country pretty much saying, who was that dysfunctional and very odd woman you had on Friday night telling this extraordinary story about her and Charlie Haughey? That is clearly not true and couldn't be. And you really ought to be,
yeah,
more discerning about the sort of people you have on the,
really,
show. And there was quite a bundle of those letters.
Did you get the impression Terry Keane was uncomfortable telling that story?
Well, she must have been, mustn't she?
Yeah,
she must have been.
So.
But she had to do it, because that's the deal with the publisher, the deal with the Sunday Times, and all of that sort of thing. We
and
all know.
She went on to, I think, say, didn't she, that she regretted coming on the show.
She did later on,
yes,
I suppose she did. Yes, but there you go. That was part of the deal. Oddly enough, Mo Mollum,
yes,
was on the same night.
Right.
And Mo Mollum was one of the very few people who came on and got an instant, spontaneous standing ovation when she came on.
Like yourself.
And Mo Mollum would have been the story of the next day,
yes,
had it not been for Terry Keane,
yeah,
and her story.
Your old pal Frank McNamara joins us tonight, Gay.
Indeed.
And Frank, you're very welcome. Fond,
right,
memories looking back?
Oh, some fantastic memories.
Yeah. I know Boney M were your favourite. Were they your best band? Why were you such a fan of Boney M?
Well, it wasn't that I was a fan, but I learned a lot about show business and the vagaries of show business. The very first Late Late Show that I did,
yes,
in 1979, they were on the show, and they were absolutely huge at the time. And you might remember, Gay, they had to have 4 white limousines.
Of course they did.
And there were, at the time, in 1979, in Dublin, there were only, in Ireland, there were only 2. And 2 had to be brought in. Is that right, Maura?
Yeah. A bit short.
2 had to be brought in from the UK. Anyway, 10 years later, exactly 10 years later, 1989, the first show of the season, Boney M were on again.
Yes.
And as I was coming into the television building, I saw them getting out of a high ace van. that's show business.
That's show business,
that's
right.
That's show business.
Where's Keith Duffy? I know Keith is with us tonight.
Keith,
do you remember when they came on and did the dance?
I do.
Do you really?
It was a wonderful moment in television history. Acknowledged by all.
It's not that he has to remember from the original time. I mean, how many times have you played it since?
Many, many times, Keith.
Many times.
Yeah, we're not going to do it tonight to save your blushes, but...
Thank you very much.
But do you remember, I think you...
Keith, it was part of our comedy tape. You
know? Yeah. Thanks, Gay.
Do you recall it?
I recall it well, and I thought, you know, Gay had redeemed himself, and now he's gone and said that it was comedy. Yeah. We're back to where we started.
Yeah. Well,
Gabo laughs back.
Again. Anyway, thanks for coming along,
not a
Keith.
Lot.
To be serious again for a moment,
yes.
The item that struck a lot of people was not an item, if you know what I mean. You were doing a competition call. You were giving away a car. You made this extraordinary phone call to a woman. We're going to play the clip and ask you to reflect on it in a moment. Yeah, we have. It's quite striking.
Are you happy, Rita?
Yes.
Were you watching the show tonight?
I wasn't. My daughter died last night.
Oh, no. Oh, dear, Rita. I'm very sorry. Oh, dear, oh, dear. How old was she, Dot?
Pardon?
How old was she?
33 years of age.
And why did she die?
Are you being funny?
No. Why did... What did she... What
she
did
was
she...
knocked down. She had a fatal car crash last night.
Where did this happen?
In Choker.
And was she driving?
Or
was
no. She... No, she was walking.
She was walking.
She was knocked down by a car.
And she was knocked down by a car?
Yes.
Good heavens. Well, Rita, I don't think we can continue with this in the circumstances.
Okay.
I was going to ask you a question. Do you want to?
I do.
Oh, you do? I was holding in my hand the postcard that the girl had posted on Tuesday. And in all, we had this big plastic thing with hundreds, if not thousands, of postcards from all over the country.
Yes.
Postcards, mark you, with the halfpenny stamp on them.
Yes.
Anyway, out of all of those, this card came out, and I was holding it, and she told me that her daughter had been killed. Mercifully, I had on the panel that night Brendan Kennelly,
yes,
who's
here
tonight,
with Doodle, yeah.
And the hermit nun from Westport, or out the west coast,
sure.
Somewhere. And Brendan did a lovely piece of poetry to cover the situation,
yeah.
And the nun did
reflected.
A little piece to cover it. And then she insisted on asking the question,
yes.
and she got the answer, and she won the car, and
yes.
That was it. And I know that Maura kept in touch with her for quite a while,
yes.
Afterwards. And the point about all of that, apart from the sadness and the terrible,
yes,
tragedy
course.
Of it, the point about that from the showbiz point of view is,
yes.
It could only have happened on a live show.
Yes.
And if it had happened on a recorded show, undoubtedly, and this would apply to RTE and BBC and ITV and Channel 4 and everything, undoubtedly somebody upstairs would have said, well, of course, we can't put that out. Yeah. Why? Well, we couldn't. We can't put it out. Cut it. And it would never have gone on air. But because the show was live, And the odd thing about it is, too, that I've always said that people remember television shows and radio programs and theatre shows, mm-hmm. and anything presented. They remember moments. They don't remember the entire show.
Right.
They remember good moments or bad moments. And if you ask people around the country, that particular spot came at the very end of the show. Obviously,
yes.
the postal quiz was always there. And it was about 10 minutes in length or whatever. And people remember that moment. If you ask them what else was on the show that night,
yes.
They've no idea.
It is the live thing, isn't it, about the Late Late Show?
It is the live.
You know, when
yes.
guests come from the United States or from the UK, they're always going, what time do we start recording at? You know, and you're saying, no, this is it now.
This is it.
Is that part of the
thing?
And
it frightens them. And there are so few crews in the UK,
yeah.
who do live television.
Mm-hmm.
They all record. And that is why our crews... Is that Anne? Anne is on tonight. Hello, Anne.
Yes,
good evening
she is. Working the cameras, as always.
Yes, she's chief. And that is why they are so... They are so expert at doing live shows, you know. And
you hung up your boots, as it were, the Late Late Show boots, not your broadcasting shoes, in 1999. And one man was only one man could fill those shoes in many respects, and he was Mr. Pat Kenny. Have a look at this.
Never heard of him.
Never.
This could have been one of my wildest fantasies.
No, I was in a soft spot for Irish men. Oh, dear, oh, dear.
Hopefully, people know that I'm totally real. I just look totally artificial.
This is it.
It's very difficult to actually get moving.
Yeah.
Have you pulled the fastest one of all time, really?
Like getting praise abroad, and coming home to the most squalid and sordid and mean-minded campaign I've seen in my lifetime.
It is disgusting that we're allowing people to die when we have billions.
We just feel it's someone she would have known or someone she could have identified.
right?
Do you think that there will someday be a united jurisdiction on this island?
I would say, honestly, God forbid.
Would you welcome, please, Mr. Pat Kenny,
ladies
and gentlemen.
Yay!
It's such a pleasure to have you on the show tonight. Thanks for coming.
It's
along.
A strange.
It is an odd thing, right enough. I'm not too sure about it at all.
It's kind of like Macbeth without the cauldron, is it?
No, it's strange to be in this position and not that position.
I know.
The
I
angles
know.
Are all wrong, and I feel it's utterly familiar and yet strangely strange.
I can imagine. What do you recall your first night, the jitters and all that goes with it?
It is one of the few times in my life that I was genuinely terrified of television. I remember doing Eurovision in 1988 with Michelle Rocca, hundreds of millions of people, and I relaxed utterly. Red light went on, no fear.
Yes.
Following this man,
total
fear.
Yeah, I can imagine.
At 37 years doing the show, and I knew there was an expectation that no matter who it was, that they would not be good enough to fill Gay's shoes. And in truth, I wasn't, and I amn't. You can't follow a legend.
Oh, come on now, don't be like that.
Hugs all around.
And by the way, you're not either.
Well, can I go home now? Yeah,
while the going's good.
But thanks for sharing the humility with us tonight. I should say that the Gay's shadow is quite long, isn't it?
He casts a long shadow. He has big boots.
He has big boots.
Could we talk about the show and stuff?
We're going to do that.
Gay.
Yeah. We've got a big long night ahead of us, Gay, so don't worry about it. We're loads to talk about.
Don't nod off.
We'll be sent off very soon, which is...
I hope.
Looking at the selection of clips from Dance for the Years, Pat, one of the more striking ones is the Joe O'Reilly interview, which, of course, became so, totemic in many respects. Let's just, again, quickly remind, and then we'll talk about it in a second.
It's just my own personal belief is that she knew the person because why else would you kill her? If it's a violent robbery, why go to the extreme of murdering the person unless they can identify you? And that's why we've talked about this and practically nothing else for the last 3 weeks. We just feel it's someone she would have known or someone she could have identified.
What struck you, Pat, in the course of that interview? What were you watching? What did you see?
What you do in a situation like that is you project yourself into the situation. How would I feel if I was bereft by a murder? Would I be on a television show sitting beside my mother-in-law as in control of my faculties as he appeared to be?
Yes.
I can't say, though, that we all thought, 40% of women are murdered by their nearest and dearest, so therefore. We didn't think that at all. It was somewhere floating in the back of people's minds that it was a possibility. The coolness of the man was something that was quite unnerving. Mm-hmm. And strangely enough, the most bizarre thing that I recall from that period is that Joe O'Reilly reported to the guards that some towels were missing from the house. Mm-hmm. Now, Gay, would you know if towels were missing from your house? Yeah. I wouldn't know there were towels missing from my house.
What was he like after the show? Was there a demeanor issue, if you like?
He left very quickly.
Okay.
Rose and the family stayed back, and we talked at length. Again, there was no great finger of suspicion pointing, but the body language, I think you could see from that clip, was distant. I would have expected arm around Rose, holding the hand. That wasn't there. Now, one of my hospitality people told me that Joe was very ostentatiously taking some pills before the show, and our interpretation at the time was that Valium or something to calm him down, and that might explain the cool demeanor. But when he was arrested and ultimately charged, I don't think at the bottom of our hearts we were all that surprised.
Let's move to election 2007. Again, we saw a clip of Owen Harris's tribute act to
he's
not
powerful,
an act, a tribute,
he's
but
powerful.
He is, and it was a tribute too, as we were saying, to Bertie Ahern. It may or may not have changed the face of that election. Again, we'll have a look at what he said, and we'll talk about that in a second.
Bertie Ahern could not be corrupt. You can't end up with a small, semi-detached house in Drumcondra. The most builders wouldn't even do up and sell on. compared with Hoy's mansion in Kinsale, Albert Reynolds' 15 million euro house in Aylesbury Road. The truth is the proof of the pudding is in the eating. He lives in modesty, in humility, in a semi-detached house. He has could have made millions had he been a corrupt minister. The man is consumed by his passion for the public service.
OK, well, we could talk about John Waters' demeanour in that interview, but
John is here. Yeah. Now, we, with apologies to John, we call that segment the grumpy old men segment.
Yeah.
Eamon was there, and Owen, and John.
But you know when you come off the show afterwards, you go, whew, what was that? Did you have that with Owen Harris, or did you just think that was Owen being Owen?
I thought, at the time, that this could change the election.
Did you?